Welcome to everyone who is joining us today for our sixth and final episode of our Back to Basics on Java series. So we're welcoming back Sandra Algrim with us today, who is delivering today's session, which is Use Containers for Java Applications. This session will run over 25 minutes, and we will have a couple of minutes at the end for any questions and answers that come through. So do feel free to ask as many questions as you like today. We'll try and get around to them all by the end of the session. Just a quick word before we start on our code of conduct. So just a reminder to everyone to be friendly and patient throughout today's session. Our communities support people of all backgrounds and identities, so just to really be welcoming and respectful to everyone who is on today's call, and whether that's throughout the comments or chat and things like that. Today's session will be recorded and will be made available to watch on demand alongside all of the other sessions that have happened over this series. So I'll just be dropping some links into the Q&A today for you to be able to access those. So I'll hand over to Sandra to get us started today.
Welcome everyone. Welcome to Use Containers for your Java application. I'm Sandra Algrim, and you should find and follow me on Twitter at @screamheld. I'm a cloud advocate working for Microsoft on Java on Azure. Just a little bit about myself. So I'm Sandra Algrim. I'm a software developer. I would call myself also a DevOps engineer because I'm a huge fan of everything automated. And I'm a huge Docker fan as well. So I'm organizing the Berlin Docker Meetup for, I don't know, many years now. It's getting a bit down due to the COVID reasons, but I'm very happy when we can get back to in-person events. And yeah, as I said, find and follow me on Twitter for more content. And we also have a Java on Azure YouTube channel where we have even more hands-on workshops and tutorials. So for today's sessions, it's kind of an introduction to Docker, and we will also take a look at best practices for your Java applications in Docker containers. First, we will talk about why we even consider using containers, then what and why we use containers and what they are, especially when we compare them with VMs, then how to use containers in Docker files with some best practices, where we will talk about smaller images or smaller and Alpine images. And then we'll have a short overview on container orchestration solutions, and I will give you some hands-on and some time for questions. So without Docker, we had a lot more things to do. First of all, I had to configure my IDE. If I used different Java versions, I always needed to make sure that I'm with the right version right away. If I use containers, I could use, or I'm using several versions, for instance, of Java 8, 5, oh, okay, 5 is bad, but 8, 11, 14, 15, whatever I'm using. And there was also more fear involved. So whenever, especially for rollouts, so if I have a new version in production, when I worked at some product teams in my previous companies, we had like tomorrow morning or in 1 week, Monday, we're gonna do an update and we will meet at 7 a.m. And I was like, why do we meet so early? And they were like, yeah, there's always something to happen. You never know if we have all the patches. So we need to have a lot of manpower in the room, and also we need to get enough time. So we meet very early at the day to make sure that we can go at home, hopefully early enough. So yeah, I really thought there would be some fear involved. And it was also more effort. So we need to make sure that all the server configurations have the same like on our development machines, or at least in our test environment. So yeah, it was a lot more effort involved to check that everything would be the same and to be more confident about our rollouts. And then this famous works on my machine. So if there were any issues, for sure, the ops team will come to the developer and say, hey, what's happening? I did the rollout and it's crashing. So what did you do wrong? And I'm like, I'm the Java developer. It worked perfectly on my machine. So hands up for whom said this already in the previous career, right? And yeah, and then multiple services can be hard to maintain. So we're all going towards microservices or even or at least smaller services. And then you kind of get into the point or into the stage where you have to maintain a lot of them, and they will also take a lot of time. So you probably need to take care of them, orchestrate them, find a solution how to manage them. There are even companies like Netflix saying that they don't even know how many services they do run actually in the end. And it's so much less fun. You shouldn't be afraid of putting something live to production or to deploy something on your machines. So how can we go on? Yes, and this is where containers and Docker came into place. I will talk a bit of the histories of containers, but there are others who already did that even better than me. So it all started with 1979, where the C-Root System Core was introduced. So we went towards more separations, and yeah, then a lot of container formats appeared, and the most famous one was definitely Docker, because they drove in 2013, they made it even more useful, or it was much more easy to use it. It's even the same on all machines. So if I'm on my Mac like I am now, or on a Linux machine or a Windows machine, it's always the same commands. It's very easy to use. You will see that at the end of this session. So yeah, and this one, and then we had kind of a container war, like there are so many container platforms like Rocket or CoreOS. Oh yeah, CoreOS is from Rocket, but Red Hat bought it in 2017. And I mean, nobody doubt that Docker won this race. So we will all talk about Docker containers. Nobody's talking about any other container solution like Warden and so on nowadays. But wait a minute, I just heard that Kubernetes isn't betting on Docker any longer. Should I even take care? Like, it's 2021. Is it still interesting for me? So yeah, don't panic. There is still Docker involved. So it's only the runtime which got deprecated. So Kubernetes will use Containerd, but that's still part of, still coming from Docker, like the company Docker did that, contributed it to open source. So we will still put everything in Docker containers, but not the whole Docker environment or infrastructure is working with Kubernetes any longer. They just put the modules they needed, which is Containerd, and leave the rest as fine, but it's still Docker in the end. So don't worry about this. Having this said, let's have a look what Docker actually is for us now. So we have like different names. We have those Docker, we have Docker files, we have Docker containers, and Docker images. And if we look at a container, we would put everything we need just inside. So you have your application, then your application has probably some configurations and parameters, and obviously the programming language. So I would just put, or I would just try to put everything I need in one place, in one container. So I have my app, the programming language like Java, specifying the version with this, then my environment configuration. Maybe I have some ports needed, or I would need to access a database. So I would add the connection strings there as well, or the information, as well as some app configuration I might need. And then I just put this in a container. And why would I want to do this? It's because it should run anywhere the same. So I have my Dockerized app, and it can be either a Windows container or a Linux container, which probably doesn't make sense too much as for me as a Java developer, because I mean, the JVM should be agnostic itself, but yeah, for other languages it's even more important. So I have my Dockerized app, and it runs anywhere the same. If I'm on my local machine, or at my data center, or a cloud, or even at another service provider. And that's very sweet. So there isn't any works on my machine left. But how does it work? How can we make sure that this will work? So we have containers and VMs. For VMs, I would have my infrastructure, and there runs some host OS on top, and then I have my hypervisor in place, and then I go here with my VM itself. and each VM would have its own guest OS as well. But the thing is, there's probably no business value in my OS. I just have my Java app, and there is all the business value inside. So why would I need more than just one OS? And that's where we use containers. So we have just the container engine, which is containerd, or the Docker engine. And then I have here my containerized app with all the dependencies, bins, libs inside, and it just runs. So I get rid of this double OS here, which is interesting for patching and everything, but also for licensing. So if I go with Windows, I would have here in the VM setup one license to pay for this host OS, and then even more for all my guest OS. Whereas if I go with containers and with Windows Servers 2018 and 19, I can just go with Docker containers or the Docker engine here again, and I would only have to pay one license here for the OS. And also I only need to patch this one, which is very cool. So it's even more secured and easier to maintain. So how can I use Docker? First, I need to create some Docker files, which are not so hard to do actually. And then I could just run any image on MIME. So for a Docker file, I would always start with the form statement and then say from which one I would go. And maybe it's, I'll just copy, go on with this and do some demos later. And then I can copy some things to somewhere. It's getting more easy more easy to understand with some examples then. I can also add some work gears. So if my code structure has it, I can set some environment variables and then I can run some commands. I can also expose some ports, what I would need for all web applications, and I can also run some commands here. And for a Java app, it might look like this. So here's a Hello World Java app. This one is using Vertex, which is one of my favorite frameworks. And yeah, so you just create an HTTP server like this with Vertex, and then here you have the Hello World message. And it listens to a port, which is given by an environment variable. And the Docker file then can look like this. So I go with Maven, so I take the Maven base image, I go to my workdir, which is in /app, copy everything I found here, run Maven install, set my environment variable with 80, expose this port that I can access it later, and then I will start my container running this command, java-jar, and then the jar file I created with the Maven install command. So what you do is, usually you can also run your Java app just from the terminal with this command, but this time you will just do it with the container. So I downloaded Docker just today because I had a new machine again. And let me just open up my terminal. There we go. Let me make that bigger. Okay. So let's see if I have Docker installed. And here you can see I have Docker installed. So and now I can do something like Docker run Hello World, just out of the box. I did nothing else than installing Docker. So and this one will say unable to find image Hello World locally. So what's happening now is that it checks at the Docker Hub, which is the official registry for a Docker image, which is called Hello World. And then it will, because it couldn't find it on my local registry. So the registry is where all the Docker images, so kind of the recipes of my containers, are stored. And I got my local registry when I installed Docker Desktop. And I have it up and running. You can also see this on this very small icon over there. So, and it couldn't find it locally, so it went towards Docker Hub because that's the official place where you find all the Docker images. So it's the registry, it's like GitHub for code basically. And then it's pulling it. And as I said, I also want to run it, it also started this one. And this one said, hello from Docker. So my Docker daemon is just working fine. And I could also even do next things like run a whole Ubuntu bash one. And that's also running when you're on Windows, which is very cool. So if you're on Windows 10, you can just run this command and then have a look at this Linux container right out of the box. And with Windows 10, you can even run Linux and Windows containers side by side, which is very cool for testing purposes on your local machine. So, and this time we are going here with Maven. Okay. So you can go like this and just containerize your Java app. And after you containerized it, you can use it with the commands we just saw, so the Docker run command, and you could even give it some options like minus P or minus minus port. And if you want to pull the image from the registry, you can use Docker pull. If I just go with Docker run, it's not having it, it will do the pull itself. And Docker build, that's what you use if you are developing your personal or your container locally. The Docker container ls, you can see all the containers you already have. You can do this. Yeah, so there's no container running. And if I go with minus a, it will also show me what I ran before and when those were created. And with Docker RM, I can remove my containers again. So what I can do here to free some space again, can go with Docker RM, and I think I can just add some numbers here. So I just deleted this, and I don't have to type all the container ID. It can just start. And if I have a look what's going on there, there's only one left, an Nginx container. And I can also remove my images with Docker RMI. So, best practices. What I don't like about the solution we just saw is when I deploy it like this, I would have Maven also in the container of my deployed image. And actually, I don't need that. I should always go for very small images. And for this, I can first of all ignore all the files that are not needed to end up on production for some testing purposes. So I can ignore all the testing classes, for instance. And then I should always go for the Alpine versions. Those ones are the smallest versions for each, or usually the smallest ones. We'll have a look at this one later as well. And then go for so-called multi-stage builds that will even reduce the surface by almost 100, so by 98% if you have a Go application. And for Java, I got it reduced. So with the Maven file, I had a Hello World application with 765 megabytes. And using the Alpine version, I was with 122 megabytes. And then going with multi-stage build, I ended up with 87.2 megabytes. So I saved 89% of size, which is great because it's less secure, less surface for vulnerabilities. I'm also not having, I can scale faster, I can deploy faster. So there are only advantages in having small images. So where can I find the Alpine versions? So usually you go on Docker Hub or Docker Store. Docker Store is kind of trying to make some money. So you can even buy images, which makes sense because you can, especially for microservices, you can benefit from it very well. So, and on hub.docker.maven, which is here, you can then always see all the supported tags and Docker files. And here we have the JDK versions, and then always go for the smallest ones. Here you can see the sizes. And then there should be something like Slim or Alpine. Here's the Alpine one, for instance. And it's much smaller than the other ones. So try out if this one is working for you as well. And it's not that hard to just add another tag for your base image and then save a lot of time and also cost. And then have a look at multi-stage builds. So it's kind of a container stack, and each stack starts with a form statement, and it's also helping you for the separation of build, test, and deployment. So I can have each stage could do one thing, like the first one will just build my image in my application, the next one will then test it, and in the last one I will just take the smallest thing, so the little jar file, and then deploy it just in a runtime environment. So like here, for the build stage, I would just take the Maven Alpine version, call it build. So each stage starts with the form statement. And just I go in my app folder, copy everything again, and do the Maven install. And then for my deployment one, I will go here for this one and take the JRE Alpine version, which is like the smallest thing I can use for OpenJDK, just to run this jar file, and then expose my port, set the environment variable, and then just run this Java minus jar file here. And here you can see copy from, so build, so that's is this one. So I gave it the name build and I can reference it here. So what it does, it takes from this stage, from this small container, like this one, could be this one here, the jar file, because that's all I need for the next step here, and then deploys it. So I have everything containerized and up and running. What do I do next? And that's container orchestration. So I can go with Docker Swarm, which is the solution provided by Docker. It's, I think everything runs on Kubernetes nowadays. So Kubernetes is definitely the winner from the orchestration race. We from Microsoft also bet on Kubernetes. And we also do by providing and working with VMware or former Pivotal on Spring Cloud. So Spring Cloud is the easier to maintain solution for Java, especially for Spring applications, which are running in Kubernetes. But you don't need to orchestrate, or at least not by hand. Everything is done automatically for you. You can just use your Spring apps, deploy it there, and just run it. Or you go with Kubernetes, as it is the winner of the race. So, and if you want to deploy it with CI/CD, you would have your dev environment like here, where you code run and debug your code in your IDE of your choice. It's supported everywhere, I think. It's in Visual Studio Code, in Visual Studio, Eclipse, IntelliJ. All of those have great Docker support. You can even debug in your container very easily. Then you push your code to your code repository. Is it on GitHub or your local Git or Azure DevOps or GitLab, wherever? And then this one would probably automatically start your CI/CD pipeline, where you have first the build step, which will run the test and then push your Docker image towards a container registry. And that can be either Docker Hub, if you're working on an open source project, or the Azure Container Registry, if it's a private one, and then secured and everything. It can be an ASP.NET app, or as we are talking about Java, a Java app, or any other one. And then the next deployment step would then go to the registry, pull the image from there, and then deploy it with all the dependencies like connections to an SQL database in your cluster. It can be a Kubernetes one, or it can be Azure App Service. Like here, if I go now and create a web app on Azure with App Service, I can always choose not to publish as code, but as a Docker container. And that would free me from all potential dependencies, because I would have the full control what's inside my container. As we just learned, containers will run everywhere the same because you're putting all the dependencies in your container. So there's no surprise. And whenever I checked, it's even faster to deploy it in a Docker container than with code, because it's usually much smaller when we use, for instance, multi-stage builds. So thanks a lot. I think time's running very fast. So for the hands-on, if you don't have any free resources for Azure, you can go on aka.ms/az-free. And then we have a cool learn module to learn even more about Docker and want to learn more about Spring Cloud and the one for containers. I don't know if you are aware, we have this MS Docs and MS Learn. And here you can browse for a lot of free learn content. And one of this is for Docker containers. And here you can, in 32 minutes, learn everything again. So a nice introduction. What is Docker? How do Docker images work again? How do containers work? When to use it? And also a summary. And if you're interested in Spring Cloud, we also have a module for this one. It's at aka.ms/az-learn-spring. And now we have time for questions. But first, thanks again for attending. And if you want to contribute and give back, we have some very cool thing to give away for you. It's $10 from Open Collective. You can then spend or give away to your favorite open source provider. So thanks a lot. And Emma, do we have any questions?
Thanks, Sandra. Just keeping an eye on the Q&A, we had one come in early on from Simeon, I believe, asking if there is a repo somewhere with the template available.
You mean with the Java one? Yeah, there is one. I will send it out later. I will probably post it on Twitter.
Sure. Yeah,
I have it on GitHub, or you go for my Sandra Algem account on Twitter, on GitHub, then you would find it as well.
Brilliant. Great. I don't see any other questions coming through, but we do have a few minutes. So if there are more, please feel free to send them through and we can get around to them. Sandra, it's been such a pleasure to have you back again, and thank you for wrapping up this series for us. For everyone who's joined us along the way as well, I'd just like to say thanks for joining our sessions and being part of them. And I guess the learning doesn't need to stop here. You can always go back and revisit the sessions that we've delivered. They're all available to watch on demand, as well as links to the relevant learn modules to continue that learning and to really keep it up. So I'm just going to post a link to where you can access all of those details. Great. I don't see any more questions coming through, so we can wrap it up there. But thank you once again, everyone. Really hope to see you back at the next series that we have upcoming. Keep an eye on our meetup groups. And if you'd like to give any feedback from today, I'll just post in how you can do that on the Reactor survey. And then there's an event code that you can pop in. So that would be very much appreciated. But we'll wrap it up there. Thank you once again, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks. Bye.